Creelman.
Here.
Counselor Amaro.
Here.
Counselor Cogsaw.
Here.
Counselor Chapel.
Here.
Counselor Jordan. Counselor McGlaughlin.
Here.
And Counselor Pearson.
Here.
Thank you. Would you all join me in the Pledge of Allegiance, please, to the flag?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, I have before me here the minutes of meeting number 10, 91-92, that was held on December 9th, 1991. What is your pleasure?
Mr. Chairman, I move we approve the minutes as presented.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion or debate on the minutes? All those in favor? 6-0 vote. Thank you very much. Let me just let people know in the back there that there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 or so seats up in the front. If you want to rest your weary bones, come on right up. I'd like to now proceed to the area of the agenda entitled Reports and Correspondence. I have three pieces to discuss. Briefly, I wanted to let citizens know that there is going to be a public meeting on the 1992 budget for the County of Cumberland. This will be held at the County Courthouse at 142 Federal Street in Portland at 4 o'clock p.m. Tuesday, January 21st, 1992. Anyone interested may submit written recommendations on the 1992 budget to the Commissioner's office. And again, that would be a 2142 Federal Street in Portland. Commissioner Richard Hughes represents Cape Elizabeth as one of the three Cumberland County commissioners. So if anyone has any interest or desire to communicate to the commissioners their thoughts, please, by all means, send them in or come in person at the budget hearing itself. Secondly, I'd like to acknowledge the fact that we received a very nice letter from J.F. McGowan, Captain of the United States Coast Guard and Commanding Officer, thanking the town of Cape Elizabeth for allowing the use of Fort Williams Park as a deployment location for the Naval Mobile Inshore Undersea Warfare Unit that was held back in September 24th, 1991. The Coast Guard was very thankful and noted that the use of the fort was critical to the success of their operation. And lastly, the council saw this issue before, and I'm bringing it up again because of a couple of reasons. It's entitled Reinvest in Hometown America. This was on our agenda some time ago, perhaps it was even about a year ago, but Councilor Day, Carol Day, gave our town manager in person a copy of some of the talking points with respect to Reinvest in Hometown America as a resolution. And in conjunction with receiving that from Councilor Day, I received myself in today's mail a letter from Glenda Hood, President and Mayor Pro Tem in Orlando, Florida, President of the National League of Cities, indicating that indeed reinvesting in America is one of the five largest priorities for the upcoming year. So all things considered, I think it would be reasonable to address this issue again, and perhaps we can get that on our agenda for our February 1992 council meeting. That concludes my reports and correspondence. Other reports and correspondence, please. Counselor Jordan.
Mr. Chairman, I just want to report that the new jail committee, which I am a member of, received their bids, and they come in very favorably. It was $339,000 under the estimates, and so they'd be, construction would start the last of February, 1st of March.
Thank you very much. Again, a sign of the times that bids are coming under by substantial amounts. That's, I guess, good news if you're going to build.
One thing.
Mr. Manager.
Yeah, about a month ago, the town received the results of a lawsuit that had been filed in Superior Court against the town by FS Plumber involving a case at the end of Eastfield Road. The town council informally, because of a 30-day period when they weren't meeting, we had individual discussions over the phone, and they agreed that it would probably be in our interest to appeal that decision to the state law court. Basically, the town attorney felt very, very strongly that there were a number of errors in judgment by the Superior Court judge who made the decision. The estimated cost of the appeal, as determined by the town attorney's office, is $4,000, and the case probably will be decided sometime in the next 6 months, but we really can't be sure of the exact date, depending on the court schedule. Thank you.
Other issues with respect to reports and correspondence? All right, thank you very much. I apologize, I did take reports and correspondence out of order, and I'm going to go back now to citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. This is a portion of our meeting every month, both at the beginning of the meeting and at the end of the meeting, there's an opportunity for citizens to discuss particular items that are not specifically on the agenda. Could I just have a show of hands this evening with respect to how many people would like to address the council on this particular category, citizens' discussion? I see, how many hands are over there? Two over there. There are two total hands, okay. Why don't, sir, Mr. Gorham, why don't you come right up to the podium? And Mr. Gorham has asked me prior to the meeting to distribute to all of the people up here a yellowed copy, so if you want to perhaps put that in front of you, that might be helpful to look over. And then when he concludes his remarks, I have been asked to distribute another packet, but I won't confuse everyone for the moment. What I will just mention at the beginning, however, before, since there may be other people coming into the meeting tonight, the council rules do indicate that comments should be limited to approximately 5 minutes. So we want very much to, I know a lot of people are here because of two public hearings, any and all people who want to address the council, we have a 15-minute block of time to use that begins now. Thank you.
Okay, my purpose in addressing you tonight is to talk about the Cape Elizabeth zoning ordinances, and specifically that part of the ordinance having to do with section 19-4-7 B and D, which is titled Conditional Use Conversion to Multi-Unit Dwelling. It appears that this section of the ordinance is not clear and can be interpreted in different ways. The zoning board is on record in saying that they do not agree with the ordinance and would rewrite it if they could. It is my strong conviction that this section of the ordinance is in dire need of study and revision immediately if the humanitarian goals of the town council and the town are to be met. My purpose here tonight is to show why the ordinance is not working. I have researched all the conditional use applications in Cape Elizabeth going back to 1983. In addition, I have researched the conditional use or conversion to accessory apartment ordinances in the nearby towns of Falmouth, Yarmouth, Cumberland, Gorham, Scarborough, and South Portland. But before I move on to that, let me read from the Cape Elizabeth Comprehensive Plan drafted on February 1st, 1990, which is about 2 years ago. It reads, "The goal to promote more diverse and affordable housing stock in terms of type and cost that will allow for a heterogeneous population," end of quote. Under recommendation implementation steps, quote, I mean, this is an important point, quote, "The town should revise the zoning ordinance to increase a homeowner's ability to create an accessory apartment unit," end of quote. Next, I would like to read a recommendation of the Affordable Housing Committee dated February 28, 1989. On page 10, under recommendation 7, we read, quote, "Review all ordinances to determine whether they impede the development of affordable housing. Any excessive or unnecessary requirements should be modified or deleted from the ordinances," end of quote. And under recommendation 8, we read, quote, "Reconsider provisions for accessory apartments and owner-occupied dwellings. Such units would provide rental housing," end of quote. I believe that when the zoning ordinance was revised in July 87, that the conditional use standards should have been separated from the conversion standards. When this separation was not done, the zoning board, staffed by three lawyers, grabbed onto the number one standard, which reads, quote, "Any condition prescribed for such conditional use will be satisfied," unquote. And the board used this vague and confusing standard to justify the denial of conversion to accessory apartments. They said it gave them almost unlimited power. Likewise, the conditional use standard number 4, which reads, quote, "The proposed use will not adversely affect the value of adjacent properties," end of quote. I contend that this standard was meant to apply to home occupations, private schools, child care centers, and so on, but not conversion to single-family homes. Concerning the number 1 standard, I believe that the zoning board applied the standard arbitrarily to the conversion applications. For example, the zoning board, in most of the conversions approved prior to July 87, restricted the accessory apartments to specific family members. Secondly, they specified that no rent could be charged. And thirdly, that the permit would cease when the relatives moved out or if the property was sold. In addition, the board created 2 categories of accessory apartments, one called in-law apartment and the second called generic accessory apartment. However, the separate standards are not published. I believe that the town council did not delegate these specific powers to the zoning board and that they couldn't legally delegate these powers without first spelling out specific and objective measurable standards for the zoning board to follow. I would like to briefly review 3 conditional use applications in my neighborhood that were processed in the last few years, and then let us see if we can find any logic or consistency in the enforcement of the conditional use standards by the zoning board. And the first case has to do with the application of the Inn by the Sea for a conditional use application. This application called for the expansion of the inn, which abutted a residence owned and occupied by Mr. and Mrs. Rottenberg. The expansion of the inn was to consist of the following: construct 6 cottage units, increase the parking spaces by 41 units, expand and open the restaurant to the public, and construct an underwater sewer treatment system. One of the standards that they had to overcome was number 4, the proposed use will not adversely affect the value of adjacent properties. The zoning board ruled that this major expansion would not adversely affect the value of the adjacent property and cited real estate appraiser Richard Sawyer's report. And so the application was approved. Remember now, we're looking for consistency. And let us look at the second case, which is in the same neighborhood at the corner of Ocean House Road and Fessenden Road.
Mr. Graham, I'm just going to ask you to pause for a moment. We've really gone over the limit. I will ask my fellow counselors, is there anyone that would be interested in authorizing Mr. Gorham to continue beyond the 5-minute request? Okay, why don't you proceed?
Okay. The owner in 1985 applied for a conversion to an accessory apartment. The application was denied because it failed to meet 4 specific standards, one of which was that the conversion would not adversely affect the value of adjacent property. The owner in 1986 again applied for a conversion, and again the application was denied by the zoning board for the same reasons. Now in 1990, with a new owner, there was a 3rd application for a conversion. Now nothing has changed materially to overcome the deficient standards which were cited previously. However, the zoning board this time approved the application. How they could have corrected the previous deficient standards especially the one on adversely affecting adjacent property, is a mystery that I cannot fathom. And there again, there's a need for consistency. Now, let us look at the third, which is also a conversion to accessory apartment. This house is about 200 yards from the inn by the sea. This application asked for an accessory apartment for a 76-year-old disabled sister. She had been recently discharged from a hospital and needed a place to live, and so her brother applied for an accessory apartment in his home for her. The applicant was convinced that he could create an accessory apartment of over 900 square feet without making any exterior changes or modifications. At the hearing, a board member attacked the 900 square feet standard. He told the applicant that he had to deduct the following spaces from the total: deduct closet space, bathtub space, fireplace and hearth space, hall space, and stair space. The ordinance specifies only common hallways, basements, and unimproved attic areas. It appeared that the zoning board was intent on denying the application, and to avoid denial, the applicant asked that the application be tabled. At the next hearing, the chairman of the board raised the issue of traffic. The chairman stated, quote, "It does increase the traffic to some degree. It adds another car to the general traffic flow," end quote. Because the chairman raised the traffic issue, the applicant had to hire a traffic engineer to show that the accessory apartment would not create a hazardous traffic situation. And this is the first time in the history of Cape Elizabeth that an applicant for an accessory apartment had to hire a traffic engineer to help the application. And after successfully establishing that the applicant did meet the 900 square feet on the traffic standard, the zoning board next raised the issue of adverse effect on adjacent properties. In order to defend against this standard, the applicant not only hired one real estate appraiser, but he hired two experts. Both of these experts stated that an accessory apartment in this house would not adversely affect the value of adjacent property. The real estate experts were Hennessy Associates of Cape Elizabeth and Richard Sawyer of Gorham. And here again, this is the first time in the history of Cape Elizabeth that an applicant for an accessory apartment had to hire a real estate expert to support an application. What needs to be pointed out is that one of the real estate experts, namely Richard Sawyer, is the very same expert that the Inn by the Sea hired for their conditional use application. The two reports on the two properties by Richard Sawyer are almost identical. You see, the properties are only 200 yards apart. The applicant stated to the zoning board, quote, "If you argue that granting a permit for an accessory apartment changes the character of the neighborhood, then what needs to be done is you have to go back to the legislative body, the town council, and say, quote, this ordinance doesn't work the way we'd like it to work, end quote. Otherwise, what you're saying is, we're not going to pay any attention to this ordinance. If it affects adjacent values here, where there are 9 different businesses as well as 3 houses with accessory apartments, it is going to affect it everywhere else in town, so there will be no way for this ordinance to operate. I say that if you don't want to have conversion to accessory apartments, then you've got to change the ordinance." The board chairman stated at the hearing, quote, "I think that if I lived, and I do live in a single family unit, I wouldn't want to have a multi-family unit dwelling around me," end of quote. The chairman at another point in the hearing said, quote, "The direction of this town has always been single family dwellings, and maybe the council made a mistake in allowing multi-unit dwellings. It shouldn't have allowed any in this town," end of quote. And of course, the chairman voted to deny the application. Another board member stated, quote, "And so I, probably knowing, again, my own personal opinion, if someone had a multi-unit next to mine, I think it would probably adversely affect my property value," end of quote. He also voted to deny the application. And what are we talking about is justice. And about 38 years ago, while I was a graduate student in Boston, I had a good fortune to hear a lecture by Mortimer Adler on the topic of justice. Mortimer Adler, as you probably know, along with Robert Hutchins, founded the Great Books Program at the University of Chicago. It is a tribute to his talent as a teacher that I can, 38 years later, recall the essence of his lecture on the concept of justice. He related the following story. He told of a father of identical twins, 5-year-old boys, who are equally loving and deserving. One day on his way home from work, the father entered a toy store and bought a single tricycle. Upon arriving home, he presented the tricycle to one of his twin sons, and then he entered the study to read the newspaper. In a little while, there was a knock on the door, and when the father opened the door, he found the twin who did not receive a tricycle standing there. The young boy looked up into the eyes of his father and said, "Daddy, why didn't you get me a tricycle?" Mortimer Adler ended the story at that point. He didn't read a definition of justice from a law book or a book of judicial proceedings. He demonstrated that justice is something that you feel and sense in your heart and in your gut. On what door does the brother in the case cited earlier knock so that he too can request justice? In ending, the most compelling evidence in support of my position is the fact that only one single conversion application has been approved by the Zoning Board since July 1987. Why has the council delayed so long without taking action? In a time when people are being pushed out into the street or off to boarding home or nursing home, and they are costly, why do we stand by and do nothing? I ask you to please act now to properly revise this accessory apartment issue. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Gorham. Should I pass out the packet at this point to the council?
Yes.
Okay. I appreciate your comments, and in particular, if in reviewing the material that you have for us, if you would like this specific issue to be addressed by the ordinance committee, if you would just please send us a short note, and we can refer this to as an item on the agenda of our February meeting.
Thank you.
Shirley. Okay. I saw another hand. There are two people. Okay. Mr. Drinan, why don't you come right up here, and in the efforts of brevity and all, if you could get right to the point, I'd very much appreciate that. Thank you.
Thank you. My name is Edward Drinan. I'm here tonight as a representative of the St. Bartholomew's Parish Council. We have been asked by Mr. Gorham to support any efforts he may have brought forward tonight as a part of an ecumenical church effort in this town to support his plea for affordable housing. While never having met Mr. Gorham nor familiar with his history before the Zoning Board, we as a community outreach church would like to say that in general we support all of this town council's efforts toward the development and support of affordable housing, and we are in favor of any zoning regulations which allow families with their normal extensions of ailing and elderly to reside together under one roof. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Drinan. Just for everyone's information, the council did make considerable affordable housing amendments that were effective as of 12/31/91. So if anyone needs a copy of our affordable housing amendments, they are in black and white and can be obtained through the town manager or the town clerk's office. There was another hand I saw. Please, come on right up.
My name is Stan Burgess, pastor of the Cape Elizabeth Church of the Nazarene, and I'm here to speak to the town council as well on the matter of a homeowner's ability or lack of ability to be able to create an accessory apartment unit. I am not addressing Mr. Gorham's individual situation and proposals so much as I'm concerned with the general direction of the ordinances, such as he has dealt with in all of his attempts to gain an apartment unit within his home for his sister. We all know that Cape Elizabeth is part of the American dream, to be able to have a nice home on a large lot in a quiet community, and there's nothing basically wrong in such a desire. I do believe, however, it's the efforts that we may resort to in protecting that dream once it's achieved which could bring us into conflict. It is inevitable that a town such as Cape Elizabeth, with all that it offers for a quality lifestyle, will become exclusive. Because, folks, we're talking economics here, and since the principle of supply and demand applies, homes such as are offered here cost well above those in many other areas. So if you can afford it, you can purchase and maintain a home here, and that is your privilege to do so. We also know if a person is of a moderate or low income, then it is their personal life circumstances which will prohibit their being able to reside in Cape Elizabeth. However, I'm not at this time going to address the issue of affordable housing and the report of the Cape Elizabeth Affordable Housing Committee. I'm not at this time sufficiently informed and all those varying aspects of their studies and recommendations. I would only say this group has a very important and challenging task before them. They make decisions which are going to affect our community well into the 21st century. What does concern me, however, is that current ordinance, the one amended on July 29 of 1987, which does deal specifically with the conversion of single-family dwellings to multi-unit dwellings. The ordinance, as I read it, would prohibit most Cape Elizabeth residents from being able to construct within their home an accessory apartment unit. And this does disturb me, dealing with a congregation where this sort of thing comes up among our people quite often, and we realize with the aging of America, and 80 million baby boomers headed to middle age and beyond, we do need to be concerned with affordable housing for those with fixed income and sufficient care for those with the infirmities of age. And in these difficult economic times, more and more families will have children in the workplace living at home. So I would like to think that my aged mother or my working son could not only live with me, but also have the independence and privacy of their own functional apartment within the home. And under the present ordinance, I could not do that. So I'm asking you of the town council to evaluate that current ordinance and make the needed revisions. A personal statement, I would say that my situation is somewhat different than many. I am not living in Cape Elizabeth because of the standard of living that it provides, because I came here to pastor a small congregation of the Church of the Nazarene, which is located in the historic old Methodist Church building. So I came because of what I felt was a call of God on my heart to lead people in this community. And I've had offers to go other places, greater opportunities, higher salary, but I did not feel that was the way that I should go. So in a respect, I'm not living here because of what the community offers, but perhaps because of the ministry that I can offer to certain people in the community. And so I would point out we have a danger in many ordinances and many things as we look at it in enacting legislation which protects and sustains this lifestyle which we have been able to achieve. I don't want to debate issues. We could talk about apartment buildings and other things and which obviously would affect property values, perhaps quality of life. The real issue here is what was spoken of by the preamble of the Constitution of the United States when our forefathers dealt with the general welfare. So let's not be so concerned with protecting our own individual rights and forsake that which is for the common good. What is best, in my opinion, is to loosen the regulations on creating the additional dwelling units. If we're disturbed that the folks next to us might add a few hundred square feet to their house and there might be an extra car in the driveway, then I believe we have a problem. So I would close by saying we have more important issues in our country than these. Allow folks like Mr. Gorham and others to care for aged, infirmed relatives. Let's get on with the business of making this a better world for everyone. I ask you on the council, I ask all of us, to consider first what is the best course of action in all that we do, whether legislative or just everyday life. Let's take the course which is of the most benefit to others. Let's use common sense and decency. And I do want to thank you for what you have been doing, and also thank you for your consideration in this matter. And we trust your judgment, and we appreciate what you do. And I want to thank you for the time this evening.
Thank you very much, Reverend Burgess. I am going to close this portion of the agenda at this time. If there are citizens who wish to address the council on items not formally on our agenda, there will be an opportunity at the conclusion of the meeting this evening to so use another block of 15 minutes. Thank you. At this point, I would like to address item number 107, which is entitled Shoreland Zoning Amendments and Zoning Map. The item is to consider public hearing comments on proposed shoreland zoning amendments and a proposed zoning map and take any necessary action. Let me just make a couple of comments before opening up the public hearing to the public. The public hearing this evening is a continuation of the public hearing that we held at our last formal town council meeting. And since that time, we have had an opportunity to conduct a workshop on this specific issue last Thursday with a little bit of lousy weather conditions that night, but there were about a dozen individuals that did come to address the council and speak their piece on this particular item. Because it is a continuation of the last public hearing, if there are individuals who were here last time and feel they have new information that they would like to convey to us, I would be more than happy to recognize them and have you come on up and tell us what your concerns are. What I hope won't happen is a repeat of the last public hearing in terms of individuals coming up and specifically going into great detail about the specifics of an individual piece of property and how, if these amendments are passed, that particular piece of property would be impacted. We are not in a position of addressing any of the technical aspects that the code enforcement officer would rule on. So in that sense, it would really be a waste of time to use this opportunity to go into that kind of discussion. However, having said that, the ordinance in and of itself is a weighty document, 33 pages, and not recognizing the numerous correspondence that have come in on this particular item, what I would like to do before opening the public hearing to the public is to ask our town planner, Ms. O'Mara, if she would specifically go over the five issues on the memorandum that was available for us this evening, and then we can move to opening the hearing.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I just wanted to briefly go over how you've arrived at this point. The shoreland zoning amendments are a requirement to comply with a state mandate. The deadline for compliance has been extended to July 1st of this year. The state did prepare a model ordinance which a town could adopt, but the town boards had decided that what they would prefer to do is to keep the existing ordinances as much as possible with a presumption to change as little as needed to comply with the state requirements and to meet the intent of the state, but at the same time to keep all of the local ordinances that this town had already spent a lot of time on. So there are a lot of revisions here that revise shoreland zoning that was adopted in the 1970s and resource protection zoning and wetlands that were adopted in the 1980s and the wetlands revisions that were adopted in May of 1990. What I have put before you is just a very short summary. It's just a new draft that has only five changes from the draft that was considered at the December 9th meeting. The changes, I believe, are not substantive. They're mostly technical changes. I can go over those quickly. The first one is there are existing definitions in the zoning ordinance for normal high water mark of inland waters and normal high water mark of coastal waters. The word mark has been changed to line, because that's the new state-of-the-art definition that's been used by the state, and it's constantly referred to that in the draft ordinance. Secondly, the definition of the RP2 zone has been revised to reflect existing conditions, how it's currently being used. Prior to this draft, the definition for the RP2 zone was poorly drained soils in excess of 1 acre. This definition has been broadened to also include poorly drained soils that are less than 1 acre, very poorly drained soils that are less than 1 acre, and under that you also end up protecting ponds that are less than 1 acre. The third change is that the separate variance section in the shoreland performance overlay zone has been eliminated. Under the fourth change, there is a non-conformance section in the wetlands provisions, and several places in that section there are references to the effective date of this ordinance. And what has been done is to insert actual dates so that there isn't the need to go back to determine when it was adopted, and it won't change as a result of future amendments. And finally, under change number five, there has been an expansion somewhat of the existing provision in the zoning ordinance that deals with variances. The expansion is, one, to update the site in the state statute. We had not updated it since the changes that were made, I believe, a couple of years ago. And secondly, the actual definition of undue hardship has been added into the ordinance rather than just referenced into the state statute. Are there any questions?
Thank you very much. Counselor Cogswell, do you have any particular comments to make at this time as chair of the ordinance committee before I open the issue to public hearing?
Nothing any more specific than what Maureen has given you from last time.
Okay. What I might, just as a last point, do before opening the hearing to the public, I do have a letter addressed to the town council from Jerry Daigle, our town assessor, and the subject is shoreland zoning amendments, dated today. The question of how much of an impact will the proposed shoreland zoning amendments, including the buffer from critical wetlands, have upon property values needs a direct answer. If a taxpayer were to ask me this question, I would have to honestly state that there exists a potential for a loss with a buffer area. In densely populated areas, any house within the buffer would not be allowed to expand outside its footprint. The future construction of garages, sheds, and other accessory buildings would also not be permitted. In this kind of real estate market, a property with a severe use restriction could suffer a loss in value at the time of sale. Given this set of circumstances, a property owner would have just cause to apply for an abatement on the grounds that the overall value of the property had been diminished by the restrictions created by the critical wetland buffer. It should be noted that every request for an abatement from taxation is on an individual basis, and each property owner has the burden to show that a land use restriction negatively affects the fair market value of the property. In those situations where a buffer area exists, such as in the rural areas of town, the abutting property owners could benefit from the open space provided by the adoption of this amendment. Any increase in the value of abutting properties would be evident at the time of sale. The loss of value resulting from the buffer in the rural areas would not impact greatly upon the valuation of the town. I don't know if that's helpful or confusing from the point of view of land value in the context of these particular amendments, but I thought I would read that nonetheless since it had been given to us this evening in case that particular question does surface. I would now, Councillor McLaughlin.
I just wanted to say thank you to Mr. Daigle for generating this letter for us. He did this at my request at about 12:30 this afternoon. My request was prompted by some of the comments from last month's public hearing on this issue. People concerned about their assessed value with the proposals in the language that we were looking at. And it was also from one direct phone call I had, very concerned about whether or not that property owners would be able to come in for an adjustment on their assessment under the proposed language. And I do thank Jerry for addressing it so promptly.
Okay, at this point I would open the public hearing and ask if individuals would like to come to the podium and address the shoreland zoning amendments. If you would just please signify by raising your hand, and I'll try to recognize you in order, and come on right down and state your name, and we'll begin. Please, Mr. Healy, I think it is?
Yes.
Come right down.
Mr. Chairman, members of the council, my name is Michael Healy, and I'm an attorney representing Mr. and Mrs. Robert Monks. I delivered you a letter earlier in the evening, and I do not know whether all the councilors have had an opportunity to review that letter or not. And I know that time is important, so I do not want to read it to you, because I'm sure you all will read it. But basically, Mr. and Mrs. Monks own a summer home on land leased from the Sprague Corporation, and their property is located in the shoreland zone. The structure is used primarily as a summer residence, and it is in the resource protection one zone because it is within 250 feet of a coastal dune. There is no wetland on this particular parcel, and only the result of the coastal dune is the question raised. It is my understanding that approximately one-third of the Monk's 7-acre lot is located in the resource protection one zone, even though it contains no wetlands. The reason for this is that there is the sand dune, and the Monk's present structure is located approximately 100 feet from the edge of the sand dune. Pursuant to Section 19.3.9-06, which establishes wetland buffers, there's a 250-foot buffer from the point where the sand and dune grasses are replaced by upland soils and vegetation. Basically, the Monk's have plans to remove the existing structure, replace it with a permanent residence on a larger footprint and in a different location. Under the existing ordinance, they could apply for a special permit and if approved, be able to accomplish their plans. Because you are proposing to repeal that language of the ordinance, as we understand it, they would be prohibited from replacing the existing structure and fulfilling their plans, and therefore they're requesting that you consider some changes in the ordinance. Those changes are really quite simple. Under the state mandatory shoreland zoning ordinance, there is no requirement that coastal dunes be included within this wetland classification, so that we would request that you would consider deleting that reference from the Resource One Protection zoning classification, or deleting the reference to the 250-foot buffer from a coastal sand dune. And finally, the third alternative would be to leave the language on page 6 of the November 6, 1991 draft, which permits residential buildings and accessory structures in a buffer 100 feet beyond the coastal dune by special permit. And if you have any questions, we'd be glad to answer them.
Thank you, Mr. Healy.
You're welcome.
Other input? Please.
My name is Ralph Bianco of 9 Pine Point Road. Since there are so many open issues from the last public hearing, I once again have to ask the council not to adopt the shoreland ordinance at this time. The legislature has given the municipalities an extension of time until July to adopt the shoreland zoning ordinance. I believe that this time should be utilized by the town council to advocate our position with the state, as some of our neighboring municipalities are now doing. I don't see the point in my repeating all the points that I've made at the last public hearing and at the workshop. However, rest assured that I still strongly support those views. Those views, be it centered around grandfathering and the issue that I think that the state is going beyond, certainly that the town or the ordinance goes beyond the intent of the ordinance. At some point, however, I would like to understand where the council stands. Is your attitude one of helping us solve our problems, or is your attitude one of trying to come up with reasons why our issues cannot be resolved? So I think at some point, be it after this meeting, I would really like to understand really where you stand on all the issues that have been presented at this point. I'd also like to receive input from the council to see if there is any merit to you receiving some input from those of us who are impacted on putting together a draft that would lead you in a direction that we would like to see the outcome of these discussions. So at some point, if we could, at the end of this meeting or at the end of the public hearing, let me know what your ideas are on that. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Mr. Bianco. Others? Please, Dr. Gramsci.
My name is Reed Gramsci. I live on 12 Cunner Lane. I would like to state that I concur with Ralph Bianco's recommendations. I find myself in a somewhat unaccustomed position of speaking out against the shoreline proposals. I consider myself an environmentalist, but my personal feeling is that the restrictions imposed on the individual homeowner could impose considerable hardship. The town in several areas has recommended guidelines that go beyond the state requirements. Specifically, the state requirements for RP1 recommend a minimum area of 2 acres, and the town requirement is 1 acre. I feel that we need to weigh the risks of the environment versus the hardship imposed on the individual homeowner if minor modifications to homes are not made. I think in many times the hardship to the homeowner would be more than any detriment to the environment when a home is in a community that is declared a wetland and the home has existed for a long period of time. I think that the impact on that wetland would be minimal. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Please, Mr. Butler.
My name is Steve Butler. I live at 22 Farm Hill Road. I'm also a former town planner. Know the wetland protection ordinance rather well. I'm here to speak in favor of the proposed shoreland zoning provisions, especially as they concern the protection of wetlands. I'd like to just maybe address one point that Mr. Bianco talked about when he talked about budding communities and the fact that they're perhaps doing certain things to their ordinances, which Cape Elizabeth maybe should or shouldn't do. The two communities I think he's referring to are dealing with provisions that, in my opinion, to a fair degree weaken what the Mandatory Shoreland Zoning Act intends. And in my opinion, I'm not sure what they're doing would actually stand up in a court of law. So I think I would recommend to you as a council that you look closely before you talk about veering very much away from the state standards and regulations. Just like to point out to you, and you probably heard it at the last public hearing, I wasn't able to attend that hearing, but Cape Elizabeth has had a long history of protecting wetlands, and I think that's an admirable practice, and it's one that should continue. Wetlands do serve several important functions, as you're aware of, and I think it's important that no construction be allowed to occur in significant wetlands. I think it's also important that the buffer areas around these significant wetlands be preserved. I mean, the buffers serve to protect the wetlands from pollution, from sedimentation. They also serve as important wildlife habitat. I think when people think of wetlands, they think of wildlife habitat living actually in the water area. It's actually the edge of the wetland, which is where most of the waterfowl in wetland would actually live. I think, you know, until 2 years ago, the town had a wetlands ordinance. You've had one for a number of years, but until 2 years ago, you had an ordinance that allowed some filling of wetlands, of critical wetlands. And I think what the town saw at the planning board, the council level, you saw a lot of incremental filling, which I think in the end was to the detriment of the town. I think the current standards that you adopted 2 years ago filled that loophole, so to speak, and I think the result has been a positive one. And I think the proposed provisions that you have before you now had continued that stance of not allowing, not permitting filling of wetlands, and I think that's one that should be continued. For that reason and for a few others, I would support the proposed amendments, as I stated earlier, and I would urge you as a town council to adopt them this evening. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Butler. Come on right down.
Very briefly, Diane Carroll, 1 Pine Point Road. I'll say it again. When my house was built, maybe I was sitting on a wetland, but they filled that wetland, they built a house, and now it's not a wetland anymore. And I don't understand the problem. We do not live on a wetland. That is my home and my yard. It is not a wetland. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Carroll. Others? Please.
Excuse me. My name is Tom Emery. I live at 12 Juniper Lane. I'm a member of the planning board. We also have a client in the office who has an application, a zoning application. I want it clear for the record that I'm coming here as a property owner, not as a member of the planning board or representing any other interests in town. Mr. Chairman, you mentioned at the beginning of the public hearing the issue of individual lots. I've had some meetings with a planner, some discussions with a council member, and I live at Brentwood East. My lot is not affected by the buffer setback, but as we were deliberating the line before the planning board, it occurred to me that I could have bought another lot in that subdivision back in 1983, and maybe I should be more concerned about the impact it could possibly have on a lot anywhere in the Brentwood area. So if you would indulge me, what I've done is prepared a diagram that I think might be helpful in the council's evaluation of what does it mean about expansion and what possible solutions could be suggested in terms of expanding within an existing footprint. I'll keep this as simple as possible and not try to make it too technical.
I can't read it. I can see it.
I can explain it.
Okay. Then I think
Tom, you've got to take the microphone.
They didn't say Tom. Possibly turn a little bit.
I think what happens is people come up here and they talk about their individual lots and individual circumstances. That's how they can only evaluate the ordinance, and rightfully so. I mean, if it's your property and you can't put an addition on it, that has an immediate impact on one's life. That's pretty significant. But what I've done here is drawn a typical lot that I've placed on Conifer Court, anywhere RC zone in the Brentwood area or other RC zones. It's a 100-foot deep lot by 120 feet wide. Not quite the size of mine, but very close. And I plotted on the existing side yard setbacks of 20 feet, rear setback of 20, and assumed this to be a minor street, so there's a 30-foot front yard setback. The garage is 24 by 24, typical garage, and the house is 24 by 48, which is fairly large, but what it really is a 34-foot wide house with a 14-foot breezeway that's been converted to a family room. This red line shows the buildable area of the lot, and for comparison's sake, if you have a 12,000-square-foot lot, the buildable area is calculated as being 4,000 square feet, or about a third of the lot that you could use to build on. I don't know of any maximum coverage restrictions in the ordinance. In any event, that's the percentage that you have available to build on. With the garage and the house, let me see where I am here. The house takes up about 9.5% and the garage takes up almost 5%. What I'm looking at here is the opportunity to put an addition on the house, and I looked at two alternatives, one being 12 feet deep and 24 feet wide. That seemed a little small. The hatched-in area shows a potential addition of 24 by 24 feet, which by coincidence is about the same size as the garage and is about 5% of the total lot area. But also by coincidence is exactly half the footprint of the house, which 24 by 24 foot addition is a reasonable size addition. So if we were to take the existing house and garage, that has a lot coverage of almost 14.5%. If you were to add half this entire addition as I show, that would have almost, it's about a 19% lot coverage, which given the overall lot doesn't seem like a significant increase in ground coverage. And I think this helps to put things in perspective in terms of potential impact on wetlands. However, in no case have I exceeded the side or rear yard setbacks. And I bring this up specifically because I've heard of a case in town where someone, unlike the Brentwood area where the shoreline or the buffer setback is coming up along the rear yard, this person lives in a situation where they have a road between them and the wetland, and that line is coming up. So then not only are they not allowed to expand forward, that they can't even expand or move their house further away from the wetland, which to a certain extent could be considered an oddity. As I was drawing this up late this afternoon, someone quipped that, gee, I have a 6,000 square foot lot. And if we were to take a typical 6,000 square foot lot with a 24 by 24 foot garage, which would be quite large, and more of a cape, a 26 by 36 footprint, and divide that footprint in half, we'd end up on that 6,000 square foot lot with a total coverage of about 33%. Or that same building on this size lot would have a ground coverage of about 16%. So I think this helps to put into perspective what these additions mean and what the impact is in terms of ratio of existing to proposed. And if there's any way this could be perhaps looked at in the ordinance amendment, I offer it up for your use.
Thank you very much, Mr. Emery. Quite honestly, would you mind leaving that there? There may be others that perhaps could benefit if they want to speak to their own, you know, global circumstances, but it might be helpful to leave that there. Others who wish to address the shoreland zoning amendments, please.
Hi, I'm Paul Nielsen. I live at 73 Hannaford Cove Road, and I believe I left hand delivered a letter to the workshop last week. I hope you all read it. It details some of my thoughts on this shoreland zoning, and funny thing coming in here.
This was your picture?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Right. Okay. Just for the benefit.
Okay. Coming in here tonight, we were a little bit late, and I noticed all the cars in the parking lot here, and there was a young lady getting out of her car, and I said, gee, they must be giving away something free in there tonight. And she hit it right on the head and responded and said, or taking something away, which I think kind of brings my point up, and that's the fact that we as property owners do, I believe, have some rights under the Constitution to be reimbursed for a property if it's taken away from us or rendered valueless. And with that in mind, I think you've already got a very, very strong wetland zoning situation here in Cape Elizabeth. I cannot see where you can get much more stringent and strict and have too many mandates, or you're going to wind up in court every day for people, you know, that have the money are going to challenge this this situation. Yeah, that's basically it. I think you can't, you know, it's still the United States of America and it's Cape Elizabeth, and people who have owned property as I have. I've got two pieces of property out close to the water, to the ocean, one of which is 100 by 232 feet. If, as the proposal suggests, they put a 250-foot setback, where am I, you know? I mean, I'm just kind of left with a piece of property that's valueless. So basically, I'm against any further, the proposal that's up here now. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Mr. Nielsen. Others? I'm not seeing any hands at the moment. Okay, I will close the public hearing at this particular time and open the issue up for discussion among the council at this point. Who would like to address some of the seven concerns that were raised this evening or any of the other concerns or numerous letters that we have received? Councilor Jordan.
Mr. Chairman, I just want to kind of kick it off because I have been kind of in the minority in some of the thinking as far as the ordinance committee goes, and I was a dissenting vote in 1990 when we enacted the wetlands, and I'm concerned about wetlands as much as anybody else in this room. But wetlands is wetlands, and as one speaker spoke about us filling wetlands, I don't think these gentlemen or anyone that spoke or anybody who's been in contact with me has talked about filling wetlands. All they would like to do is run a post down and maybe build a deck out from their existing home, which has already been filled in and been groomed as a lot. And because they're getting so close to the wetlands and they're covering more surface area than they're allowed to do, they can't do it. And I think this is wrong, and I'm very much in favor of doing anything that I could to help them out, because I think that with this letter we received from Jerry Daigle, I think it could be, they could be lined up there in the future, and if I was in the same situation, I'd be with them. Because your, this ordinance, and the state included, is a census confiscating people's rights as far as being able to have a livable home that they feel they would like to have. And I would hope that the council, before we get done with the discussion here, would vote to table this to a future town council meeting. And the design that Tom Emery set up there on the board is something that was discussed at our last meeting, and I think the manager and I went over it, and was said that if you had a piece of property and it's been groomed so far around wetlands or what have you, that you should be able to do something on what you have been using, mowing or gardening or what have you, even though you're getting a little closer to the wetland. I don't think you're harming it a bit by running a post down through the ground to build a deck. If you wanted to build and put a foundation way out to the edge, I think that takes another look. And it all depends on how much you're adding to it and what you really need. So maybe I'll have something to say later on, but I'll close it for now.
Thank you, Councilor Jordan. Councilor Jordan brings up the point of potentially referring this issue back to the town council. I guess that's certainly an option. The other options I would see this evening would be to you know, to table the issue, to refer it back to the ordinance committee again with specific recommendations for changing the ordinance. Certainly there's no gun that we are under, so to speak. There is an extension to July 1st. I guess the real issue is what substantive changes in terms of policy are we interested in re-looking at if the ordinance went back, excuse me, if the proposed amendments went back to the ordinance committee. So it really seems we have three options. We have the option of passing the amendments this evening, we have the option of defeating the amendments, or we have the option of referring this issue, tabling the issue and referring it back to the ordinance committee. Could I just have a clarification from perhaps the town manager or the town planner? If we did vote up or down on the shoreland zoning amendments as put forth this evening, if we voted it down, what are the consequences as a failed motion? Can either of you address that?
There are really no consequences until July 1, as far as the state's concerned, other than, you know, the impacts that during the period between now and July 1, certain things may or may not happen. So you have the land use consequences as well as the mandate consequence.
People clear on that? Okay. So those are the options that I foresee possible tonight. If there are other options, please enlighten me. Or enlighten me in any other way.
Let the lady.
Councilor Admiral, please.
I'd like to, my preference would be that we'd send this back, these amendments back to the ordinance committee, and that we ask the ordinance committee to look at the whole issue of coastal sand dunes and building in the areas of coastal sand dunes, because my understanding that our ordinance now goes beyond the state requirements addressing sand dunes. That we ask the group from Pine Point and Mr. Ramsey and others who are interested in getting together a proposal for us to review, that they do that and the ordinance committee look at it and review it. And I would suspect that their proposal would have to do with allowing additions to existing properties. And let's see. And that we also address the area of former wildlands that have been filled in and built upon, and whether there should be a different standard. And I think that may be the same issue that Mr. Bianco was addressing earlier, that we also look into that issue. And there may be others that people would like to add.
I'll second the motion.
Councilor Chapel?
You got a motion, I guess, now. Did you make it?
All right, there is a motion.
Discussion on the motion.
There is a motion on the table, and there is a second, so let us continue our discussion of the motion.
Mr. Chairman?
Councilor Chapel?
I also support that motion, that it be referred back and specific things be taken up by the zoning board.
Ordinance committee.
I'm disturbed with the anything in our ordinance being in excess of what the state asks for. That bothers me as I read it, when I find that we are going to ask for different acreages in certain places than the state asks for. I think that should be looked at. I think also that we should preserve the language that permits the residential buildings and accessories sit structures in our buffer 100-foot zone from the coastal zone. I think that would be an improvement. And just adding those two, Jane, onto what you said, I would support sending that back for further review.
Okay, Councilor Cogsell.
I would like a little more specific direction from the town council as far as policy. We had four issues that we had hoped to discuss at our workshop last week, but didn't address at all. The issues were on the pink sheet. One was construction in wetlands and wetland buffer areas negatively impact wetlands. Do we feel that is a correct and proper policy or not? Construction in wetlands and wetland buffers is not consistent with state requirements, which means that's how we have a weaker approach to the state requirements, and hopefully they would approve and let us do this. Do you want to change the current policy that prohibits construction in wetland buffers? Do you want to review or change current policy that prohibits construction in critical wetland areas? Until we as a council really debate those issues, we really can't draft or modify the ordinance. And for any of those who wish to submit recommendations and ordinance language, our ordinance committee has a scheduled meeting for Thursday the 23rd. It would be helpful, if it's possible, for you to have that in our hands prior to that meeting so that we could at least study it before that meeting.
What time is that meeting?
7:30.
7:30.
Thursday. And we have not set a place yet. We'll have to take that for the scheduler. Will it be here in the town hall or back at 1226 Shore Road? Okay.
Thank you. Thank you for that input. Councillor McLaughlin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I share Councillor Coggeshall's concern. I think this is becoming what was alluded to last month, a review of our existing wetlands ordinance as much as it is a review of the proposed shoreland zoning. There are a number of councillors sitting here this evening who voted on that wetlands ordinance the first time it was before us and when we went through revisions to it in May of 90. And I'm wondering if the same sentiment exists now that existed then. I'm hearing a call for more leniency about how we deal with wetlands than I was hearing when we first passed the existing wetlands ordinance. And I need to know if
I'm reading the rest of the council correctly in that respect.
Counselor Amaro.
I guess from my perspective, I'd really like to have us review our wetlands policy as it affects existing properties that are already built upon, to see if there is some way, maybe a proposal similar to this, that we can be more permissive, but at the same time continue to protect the wetlands. I guess what I'm concerned about is that we may be being overly restrictive and at the same time not necessarily adding any improvement to protecting the wetland. So I'd like to have us at least review that to see if there is a possibility that we might be over restrictive.
With the current wetland ordinance? Okay, that's what I need to know.
Councilor Pearson.
Yes, Chairman Crowman. I wanted to concur with a lot of what's been said as far as sending the whole current proposed ordinances back to the Ordinance Committee for a few different reasons. And to answer Councilor Cogsells, as far as direction, I think that all those four issues should be addressed for many different reasons. One, impact on wetlands. I think Tom Emery and someone of his qualifications is better to answer something like this, but relative to something like that, I think part of the language has to be as far as proposed construction and its actual impact. And as far as leniency that you brought up, I don't think this is necessarily leaning towards leniency, but more towards creativity to solving a solution. I think when the wetlands ordinance was first brought up, it was a reactionary proposal. I think the whole country found themselves in a state of saying, geez, we've been doing something for so long, we've got to stop it. So then it's almost like you completely retrench, stop everything completely without being a little more creative. If someone builds a shed like Mr. Bianco alluded to, and you say, well, it's a shed, it's only an 8x12 area, how is that impacting wetland? And I posed that question to the town planner after our workshop. She said, well, any disturbing of vegetation, ground vegetation, is going to impact a wetland. But to what extent? Now, if it's the runoff because of the roof and because of the loss of vegetation, maybe you have to impose, okay, well, behind that drip edge of that shed has to be a retaining basin, which will prevent that runoff from affecting wetlands. Okay, and I think, too, I've just got so much here, I hope I don't confuse everyone completely. But if I do, that's typical. But anyways, so I think that, you know, that's some direction that the Ordinance Committee, be it if we have a biologist from the state come in and also have the public be there and just say, how does this impact a wetland? Because I don't think anyone sitting here in the audience is an expert. I think a lot have emotional interest, as Billy said that he would if it was his property, I would. I mean, there before the grace of God go I until it's your circumstance. But one thing I also want to say to the people that it does affect is you also have to, as the Pastor Burgess alluded to earlier, you have to look at everyone's condition, not just your own. You can't be selfish in this either. Just a quick story is, if I had a plant at the end of the meeting hall here, just a little plant, and I went by and picked a leaf off it, and I said, hey, that's no big deal, and it probably isn't. But if everyone in this room all grabbed a piece of that plant, that would be a pretty shoddy-looking plant at the end, and that would definitely have an effect. So every little bit of an impact, though each individual circumstance isn't that all-encompassing and dramatic, if you take it as an overall whole, it can have an effect. But I think that everyone's got to be open and creative in coming to the solution, instead of just reactionary with policy decisions. So that's my statement.
Thank you, Counselor. Counselor Cogsell.
Yes, I very respectfully would like to correct the statement, or debate the statement that the Counselor Pearson has made as far as our wetland ordinance being a reactionary type of ordinance. It was in the drafting stage for over 10 years, And this newer version that we finally accepted was working with the Conservation Commission and the Planning Board for 3 years and over a year in our ordinance committee. We have a history of trying to protect our environment and our wetlands, and so this was done very carefully with input of professionals as well. So it wasn't really reactionary, even though the rest of the country might have all of a sudden reacted. We were on the forefront. Okay.
No, I was going to say it was no insults were intended or mentioned, and I wasn't saying that this particular one was reactionary. I think that all of us, if we go through life, learn something and we react to it. So in that case, yes, we're not all soothsayers, we're not philosophers, and we can't see the future. But you know,
I just want to make sure the history was straight.
Oh yeah, well I covered it.
Councilor Amaral.
I would hope that we would all look at any ordinances that we have in this town as being not written in stone, but being evolving documents, that as we get more experience with the ordinance, that we review it, and that we address needs that arise. And that's what I hope we would do tonight by referring this back to the ordinance committee.
Jim, I have to make one additional comment. I had quite a few people call me and say they wondered if the town council knew what they were doing or were looking at this thing and giving it some thought and depth. If you have any question about that, anybody in our viewing audience or anybody sitting here after we get done, we haven't even started yet. This goes round and round and round, and we're going to do the best we can for the citizens of Cape Elizabeth in that process, getting a good, strong ordinance before you. Somebody may not be happy. I'm not concerned about that, as long as we do the best we can for the most, and you can be assured that this council is going to do that. Thank you.
Thank you. Billy. No.
I believe there was another ordinance that we need to take a look at that was brought up tonight, but I won't cloud the issue with that one there, but I think that one is a serious one also and needs to be looked at. But there's one thing that I think people lose the sight of, and I think there's one of this council lose the sight of, and I hear as people speak. They think we're here enacting an ordinance for new construction where we're going to bulldoze dirt into wetland. That isn't what we're up to mostly. What we're up to is to help these people that have a home, been there for 20-odd years, and they've laid the foundation of all their land, regardless how big it is, whether it's a half an acre or an acre. And they would like to do something on it. And I feel we should write an ordinance so they can do something reasonable on it. We're not here thinking about, and I hope people don't keep coming up, feeling that we're here to bulldoze in the brook and what have you. That is what we're up to. We're up to help these people out. New construction is a different situation. Thank you. Ready for the vote?
Did you move the question, Counselor?
I'll move the question.
Okay. We do have a motion, a second. The discussion is over. The question has been moved. All those in favor of the motion, please signify by raising your right hand. Vote is 7-0. Thank you very much. Yes.
We're still lacking direction on the first two items.
So noted, and I think that there was an opportunity to address those issues at the workshop. Let us try to address all four at the next ordinance committee meeting.
You'll be the counseling.
Thank you. Okay. The next item on this evening's agenda is a second public hearing entitled Sewer Fees. Item 108. And this is to consider public hearing comments on proposed revised sewer fees and take any necessary action. Let me just wait a moment for people to clear out.
They all realize we're talking about raising their sewer rates. Some of them
are here. Well, they don't affect them. They don't affect them.
But a lot of them are on sewer.
Could I ask that people continue your conversations outside the council chambers so we can proceed with the second public hearing, item 108? All right, at this particular time, I will defer this issue to our town manager, Mr. McGovern.
Yes. One of the unfortunate responsibilities that a town manager has is to make sure that all of the different programs of the town are run on a fiscally responsible basis. I was sorry to report to the council last month that our sewer fund is not currently being run on a fiscally responsible basis. The reason that is that last year we had an operating deficit in the sewer fund of $136,858. In addition, in this year's budget, there was a projected deficit of $80,750. We already have some of the highest sewer rates in Greater Portland. The sewer budget itself is divided into a number of areas, and I'll briefly highlight them. We do have roughly one half of one person at the Public Works Department whose salary and benefits is charged off to the sewer fund. That is because of all the different work that the different members of the department do, cleaning out sewer lines and responding to sewer issues. That's a little over $17,000. We set aside, $10,000 a year for sewer line maintenance, $1,140 for miscellaneous, $6,000 for administrative costs. A lot of that is printing. It's the sending out of the sewer liens. The certified mail, I think, was almost $1,000 this year just for sending out the notices of sewer liens. Allowance for uncollectibles proposed to be $3,000 next year, which is probably one of the best rates around for a set-aside. Town debt service during the construction of the sewer system is around $380,000 a year. However, the major item on the expenditure side is the assessment that we receive from the Portland Water District. A couple of years ago, in, let's say, 1988, it was $715,000 for the entire sewer system. In 1989, it was $612,000, actually went down. The next year, it went to $768,000, and then up to $924,000, and now is approximately $930,000. The reasons that the Portland Water District assessment have gone up are varied. Some of it is because of the fact that we used to maintain all the individual pump stations ourselves as a community, and most of that is now done by the Portland Water District. In addition, as representative of the district will relate to the council, and I think as the council is well aware, we also have a very significant problem with inflow into the sewer system. And just 2 weeks ago, I received a call from the staff member of the Maine Department of Environmental Protection asking when we were going to clean up potential overflow problem down at Ottawa Road right on the South Portland line. It is something that does need to be addressed, and funds are provided. Specifically, what I'm proposing before the public hearing this evening is a sewer rate increase of just under 15%. The reason I do that is to ensure that we do not continue to run the sewer fund on a fiscally irresponsible basis. I realize that these are difficult times, but I don't think anyone would be too much in favor of keep running in a deficit, so eventually we have an overall fund deficit. Specifically, the rates that are proposed are $34 per month for the first 300 cubic feet of measured water usage. That's an increase from $29.60, and $2.75 for each additional 100 cubic feet, which is an increase from $2.42. The Water District was very helpful in providing excerpts from their entire Portland Water District budget that simply apply to Cape Elizabeth. And here this evening from the Portland Water District are the trustee representing the towns of Gorham and Cape Elizabeth, James Jordan, Joseph B. Taylor, who is the general manager of the Portland Water District, Doug Stewart, who is the comptroller and a sewer ratepayer himself in Cape Elizabeth, and Steve Gordon, who is the director of operations for the Portland Water District. And they are here this evening to answer any questions of the public as well as myself and any other municipal official. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Michael. Is there anyone on the council who wishes to make any comments before opening the public hearing? All right, at this particular time, then, I will open the public hearing to the sewer fees and ask for particular input from any and all citizens who are out there who may have something to say positively or negatively with respect to the individual increases. I don't see any decreases anywhere in the proposal, Mr. Manager. I see a hand back there. Please come on right down. Yeah. Mr. Dennison.
Yeah. While Mr. Dennison is coming up, continue coming up, I would like to mention that, you know, the Portland Water District assessment for this particular year is not actually up that much. The fact is we were so under budgeted this past year that you know, we had hoped that it might decrease more than it did, and it didn't. So that's where we now.
Yes, gentlemen, I think it's way past.
Would you just please
time.
Identify who you are and where your home
you
is?
Herb, I called Dennison.
Thank you.
Spelling Cavanaugh.
Great, thank you.
I think it's way past time that this council and the Water District got together. Maybe you need a sewer study committee or something to watch the Water District. But I think your costs are going way out of line. I heard your manager speak of infiltration in Ottawa Road, that substantial monies were spent a few years ago. We're back with the same problems again. I question the feasibility. You say you've got a 1.5 men now in the public works. You used to have 2, and you've given up most of it. Do you need 1.5? As far as the sewer works go, I say to the Water District, you should look at your operations. When I see a truck the size, a big enough wrecker to pull a tractor trailer out, to come all the way from Warren Avenue to Cape Elizabeth, pull the half-ton truck that was stuck for 3 hours in the mud, I think Jonesy's wrecker could have done it at a hell of a lot less money. And I think you got to get together. You can't keep raising this. As you said, we're the highest. It's amazing. I can look down my road 2,000 feet. I get a $30 sewer bill. He gets a $5 or $10 one. We've got debt. We've got costs of support. But I don't think that we put enough into the operation. You just had a rate increase here a short time ago. Apparently, there's not too many people. Maybe I'm on the minority, but I think you're riding a good horse to death, and you got to look at refinancing here somehow or something to keep your rates down. I will compliment you tonight. You got something on the sign over there. I think these hearings would be nice on your sign over there, but at least you got something besides the South Portland tree lighting thing this week for you, this month for your council meetings. That is one step forward off the subject.
Thank you, Mr. Dennison.
Yeah, Mr. Dennison, you may have misunderstood. It's 1/2 of one position at Public Works for your charge. No, if I did, I didn't intend to.
But I still think maybe you need a committee. Down the Water District.
I'm thinking on the Water District. They probably won't be speaking to me. They was when I came in, when I leave. But I mean, it's awful easy to have 2 trucks when you only need one. It's still charged to the Cape thing. Maybe one man can do it instead of 2. You can point out safety just like you can in the Cape. But with your two-way radios and your communication systems today and the way the economy is, and you just had a rate increase, it hasn't been a year, and I'm sure that as we stand here tonight, this isn't going to cover. I'm sure that you're going to be looking at more another year, and as you said, in this day and time, 15%. It's time that we get the ball game together.
Other input on the proposed sewer rates. Mr. Emery.
Tom Emery, 12 Juniper Lane. I didn't come here tonight prepared to speak on this item, but since I brought this up every time I open the bill and think about how expensive water is compared to sewer, there was a discussion when the widening of the turnpike was suggested that there wasn't a concern to the taxpayer because that cost was a user fee and the burden was placed on those users, and when in fact it is, in essence, a tax increase. because it's a cost increase to each person who uses the turnpike. A concern I have is when I look at my property tax bill and I see that the sewer fee over the course of a year is starting to equal about half my property tax bill, or something close to that, or a school, I don't want to get into the school budget, but we have a municipal side, we have a school side, and now we have the sewer issue. And it would certainly soften my burden at the end of the year if I could take that sewer fee and put that in as a tax deduction, which is one of the small benefits of owning property compared with the cost of owning property. If there's any way of either structuring the sewer side of the fee, I'm not suggesting any way allowing the taxpayers of Cape Elizabeth to share someone's benefit of owning a 40-foot high water jet in their side yard. I'm just simply saying if there's a way of prorating those fees and tying them back into the taxes rather than having them as a separate non-deductible fee, particularly where we're talking about public improvements like sewer facilities. Another concern is this issue of the potential for filtration improvements, even though I understand that's not going ahead. That's a significant cost, and the only way to really, if those costs, which the federal government is no longer willing to bear, the county's no longer willing to bear, and the state's not going to bear, it certainly is in my bottom line dollar is a tax. And even though I use water, it's a public necessity, just as school and municipal services are. And it would be very helpful if those could somehow be incorporated in the property taxes and made deductible as a property owner. That's all. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Emery. Other input, please, to the proposed sewer rate issue. Don't see any other hands. Mr. Taylor, given all of what's happened in the last year or so, it's very courageous of you to come to Cape Elizabeth this evening. We thank you for that. Do you have any particular comments that you would like to make with respect to the circumstances that we face in terms of the increase in fees?
We do thank you for the invitation. It's always a pleasure to come to Cape Elizabeth, and we haven't been down here perhaps as often as we should in recent years, but during the building of the system and the things that went on before that, we were here quite often. We do hope that you realize when we put these budgets together that we do have the users and the communities and their ratepayers in mind. This year, there are circumstances with power and other things, as Mike has probably analyzed for you before this meeting, that I'm not going to go through, but we're always willing to come out. I think we need to come and answer questions, and we should stay better in touch with the councils in the communities that we serve, and we thank you for the opportunity of being here tonight.
Thank you, Mr. Taylor. Are there any questions for Mr. Taylor, as long as you're at the podium? Councilor Jordan.
Mr. Taylor, I'd like to ask you whether you have the figures of the power increase affects the increase of the water company. How much would you say Central Maine Power caused the increase to the water increase here in Cape Elizabeth?
Well, the power is in several items. In the papers that we gave you, showing up in the treatment plants and the pumping stations. I don't have that as
you didn't have it broke down.
Not
I didn't
as
bothered
one thing
to
you
do
know.
It either. Okay, thank you.
Other
on that issue, you had several conversations with Mr. Gordon this past year. In addition to the regular CMP rate hikes that we've been experiencing, Central Maine Power also discovered that they were improperly assessing the demand charge. Most of you are familiar with demand charges on the Southern Cape Treatment Plant. And Steve Gordon could answer that a little bit more in detail, but it is a major factor and something that the power company has really stuck to us.
If you're not familiar with CMP and how they do their charges, in a business, there is what they call a demand charge. And for the first 15 minutes, they will rate your usage. And based on whatever your peak is, that's what they will charge you as a minimum over the course of a year. And that's all tied into how they calculate their rates, They have minimums. They have to be able to have the generating capacity, the line capacity, et cetera. When they got called in to do an analysis, I believe it was in Kennebunk, they found that most treatment facilities or pump stations don't pump for the period of 15 minutes. And when they did that, they then began to realize that all the waste treatment facilities throughout the state probably were in the same category. So they have started their march up the coast. And they have come through to Portland now. And you're in our service area. And I believe just about every one of our pump stations got reanalyzed or adjusted in either rate structure or by what the demand was. The other big charge was at the treatment plant itself. Its design and capacity was calculated in one manner, and our actual use and consumption is a lot lower than originally designed. So they had, because of their plan investment, they had to make some adjustments there. Those actual figures we can probably give to you, but it was a sizable amount and did cause us costs.
Specifically, in the Portland Water District budget for the coming year, the 1991 plan or budget was for the Southern Cape Treatment Plant was $25,400. This year, it's $51,900 for simply for the power for the treatment plant, a doubling and a little bit.
Thank you, Mr. Gordon. Other questions or clarifications necessary from the council? Councilor McLaughlin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have a number of questions. I don't know who can best answer them, so I'll just throw them out for you.
Excuse me, Councilor, why don't I just officially close a public hearing, and at this point, since there were no other hands interested in speaking to the issue, I will close the public hearing and now open it up for specific debate here on the council.
Thank you. In the projected costs, I'm wondering why, maybe this has been said, help me understand why from 1991 to 1992 the cost for the northern system decreases and the cost for the southern system increases. That's what's happening, right? Who can answer that? Can anybody answer that?
Councilor McLaughlin asked why the overall cost for the northern system is down slightly while the southern system is up.
I would expect them both to go up.
I think what you'll find is part of it is what Mike just answered is the power.
The power?
Yeah. Power is a big factor when you're running a treatment plant. They're affectionately known in the industry as a power hog. Because you're all the time moving materials and the sewage through the plant, and that all takes power with the pumping.
Okay.
But the majority of it is right there.
The other factor, Councillor, is that the 1991 plan had a deficit of $33,700, whereas because of prior surplus funds. This year has a surplus worked in sort of as a credit to the assessment of $58,000. So that thereby lowers the assessment by $58,000 less than it would otherwise be.
Is that for one particular system or overall? Is that north or south or combined?
That's simply for the north.
Okay.
So if you added the $58,000 to the actual assessment, it would be about $35,000, $40,000 more than the 1991 assessment.
Okay. I'm also wondering if Cape residents in general, but specifically Cape residents on sewer, are getting estimated bills or they're getting true readout bills. I'm not on sewer, so I don't know if it's any different for people who are on sewer. There are some times when at the bottom of my water bill it says this is an estimated bill, and I'm wondering if that's happening with people on sewer. And how, if that is happening, how many months out of the year, they're getting an estimated bill rather than the actual bill.
Mr. Stewart, could you just come to the podium so that the viewers can hear you loud and clear?
I'm Douglas Stewart, Controller of Portland Water District. Starting in the July, August area of this past year, we switched to monthly billing. The major reason for doing this was to reduce the size of the bills that we were sending out to many of our customers, especially in the areas where we were billing also sewer, as in Cape Elizabeth. To contain costs, we didn't read the bills each month. We were doing it every second month, and in the intervening months, we were doing estimated bills. So we have increased the number of readings that we're doing with customers to 6 times a year versus 4 under the old quarterly billing method, but now we're billing 12 times a year. So if you do see an estimated bill on your water bill, it is being estimated also for sewer that same month.
Okay. Maybe you're the one to ask this question of, Doug. I'm curious what the South Portland rate is.
I don't know offhand what the South Portland's rate is, but I know it's quite lower than it is in Cape Elizabeth. South Portland is not part of our system, but we do the billing for them. I just don't know offhand the rates.
Theirs is still quite a bit lower than ours, but it's believe it or not, is increasing at a more rapid rate and is projected to because of an expansion of the treatment plant that they're doing. Now, I've spoken several times with Mary Sullivan, who's a counselor in Bangor with the Municipal Association. The city of Bangor is going up 10% on its sewer rates every 6 months for X number of years. I don't remember the exact number of years, but they're automatically going up 10% every 6 months without a council vote. They voted once, and that's it. So sewers are expensive.
I've got to say I'm astounded that we didn't have more input from the public this evening. When everybody apparently who is here for the shoreland zoning public hearing was getting up and leaving. Do they understand what's happening with the sewer rate increase? I'm astounded because I hear the concerns about property taxes and the potential increase in property taxes. This is another potential increase. I did check about the number of sewer liens that we have been dealing with. The liens bills that were due last June. The liens were sent out on those December 13th. There were about 40 sewer liens that went out this past December. They ranged in price due from $56 to $300. Now, people are having trouble apparently paying the sewer bills, but I don't see those people here tonight, and I'm very puzzled.
Are there any other questions of the council for clarification purposes? Councilor Cogswell.
My question is basically to Mr. McGovern about the possibility of including the sewer fee as part of the property assessment. That would take legislative action. That's that we could do on our own.
That's correct. We simply could not add, we kicked it around at some point. Well, maybe we ought to figure out exactly what it would be as a cents per thousand. And maybe we could just add to every home that was on sewer, said, your house is worth $10,000 extra, and you're going to account for that paying your sewer bill. Unfortunately, it just, number one, it wouldn't work because, the sewer doesn't go up at the same rate as education and everything else, and it becomes disproportionate over time. And secondly, it's simply not allowed by state statute. And the other reason why it's just not put all on property taxes because there's still over one-third of the property owners in Cape Elizabeth are not on sewer. So, they would be paying for service that they wouldn't be receiving.
A third.
A little more than a third.
is there need for any other clarification on the sewer proposal here? If not, I would entertain a motion at this point. Councilor Jordan.
I would just like to give my annual comment as far as the sewers go. And I will say that I think as last year when we went through this before again, that we was going to review, or have the sewer committee review the ordinance. Because some places it's a little restrictive as far as anybody hooking onto the sewer. And to me, if you're going to save a few bucks here and don't have an increase, you've got to increase your revenue. To me, it's like a business. You've got to generate a little more revenue to take care of your added expenses. And I think this should be done this year. So I, therefore, will make a motion that we go along with the increases that is recommended here. And I'll add to that motion that we review the sewer ordinance to see if we can't do something before 1993.
Thank you, Councilor. We have a motion. Is there a second?
Second, Mayor.
We have a motion, a second. Further discussion on this item? Councilor Cogswell.
Perhaps I should ask this question now instead of after. On the infiltration reduction on Ottawa Road, a certain amount of money has been designated for that. For some reason, I was under the impression that was going to be done by the Portland Water District, but we were going to pay for it. Is that correct?
Yeah, as it now stands, it is part of this assessment, and I've been awaiting a call from the town engineer that would, you know, hopefully start the process of specifically identifying how the problem might be resolved. We still don't have a firm estimate for doing it yet, but, you know, obviously we know we have infiltration problems throughout the system, and, you know, this one would definitely be the top priority because of the environmental body's interest in it, the DEP's interest in it.
Right. Because we had an extensive test conducted by the town engineer on infiltration problems, and he told us this was the most serious, but also we as a council decided we were going to try to address infiltration problems this year. And basically what's holding this up then is the town engineer not coming up with a proposal?
Now, it, you know, anything takes time, and, you know, the Portland Water District has had a number of discussions with our town engineer, and, you know, I'm sure he is giving it much thought, but, you know, we wouldn't be doing anything, you know, right this time of season anyway, so. You know, I think, you know, once the construction season starts, provided the monies are available, it's within budget, we can move ahead.
Councilor McLaughlin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Staying on that topic for a moment, and I don't think we're being too premature discussing it this evening, I've heard from people in South Portland about this problem, and I've also had the opportunity to attend a workshop that an informational presentation that South Portland Engineering Department put on for DEP and EPA officials. I was very impressed by some of the machinery that those people developed and had access to use for their own studies, that I think we would have to do a similar study in that area of Cape Elizabeth, and I would hope this is one area where we could consider some intermunicipal cooperation, perhaps use the expertise that has been gained by another municipality in this.
We really hope for a lot of intermunicipal cooperation, because some of the infiltration we think is coming from the neighboring community.
Sounds like a good place to cooperate.
You didn't get anywhere on that one, did you?
I got what I wanted.
Other discussion on this item?
I may just be postponing the inevitable. It's really painful to vote for this, but I think one very good thing this council did, and I can't remember when we did it, if it was last year or the year before that, when we changed the minimum amount billing. It used to be the first 900 cubic feet, and we changed it to the first 300 cubic feet. If you're... Is that right? No?
We went from 900 to 300 because we went from
quarterly
to monthly, but it's one and the same.
It's one and the same. Okay.
But to that point, we did start at 5,000. We went to 1,800. We went to 1,500. We went to 900, which is the equivalent of the 300. The water district, we've had some extensive discussions, but it was kind of too late for this process to go down to the 100. And that will be, hopefully we won't have to come back for a while with another rate increase. But, the next time the sewer rates are adjusted, it probably will be based on the 100.
I think that those
recommended that way.
Those reductions have helped people. I also did hear today in the town office that I heard something good about monthly billing. And I need to share that with the Portland Water District, because up to now I hadn't heard anything good about that. And the fact, as you gentlemen stated this evening, that people are getting more bills, but the bill that they get isn't as large a money amount. And it seems that it's easier for people to pay and keep up under those circumstances. So there was a positive comment about that. And hopefully that is what is happening, is that we're getting a better payment rate with the monthly billing, even though the amounts are still very painful sometimes. Thank you.
Mr. Cox.
I'm sorry. I just wanted to clarify something with Mr. McGovern, or perhaps Mr. Taylor from the Portland Water District. Your fiscal year runs January to December, and yet you service communities whose fiscal years run July to the end of June. Is there any way that you could change your year so that we could better project in our budget what our expenses are going to be from the Portland Water District?
I'll be happy to talk about this. This isn't the first time I've spoken about this subject. It's come up mostly at these times when we are setting sewer rates, because this is at a time when you are not setting tax rates. For the district has a fiscal year that makes a lot of sense for it. It's a construction company by and large, and at this time of the year we're not doing very much business. The construction area is closed down. It's a natural end for our business. It's not a natural end for a business. It's like a school district. The school district's natural end of its year is in the summer, when the school year is ended. I don't think it really represents a large problem, us having a different fiscal year from all of the communities that we deal with sewer. I think we've made good projections in the past on costs. I think we'll continue to do that in the future. And if there's anything that we can do to better provide further information, for you to make decisions on, we can do it. We've done it in other cities. We generally, in the springtime, try to put a projection together for the following fiscal year, which would be 1993, for the city of Portland, so they can sort of tack on that 6 months onto the costs that we've already given them. So we can provide other services to get these numbers if we need it. We don't need to change our fiscal year, and I'm not encouraging you to change your fiscal year either.
Yeah, at one point, the cities and towns did approach the legislature to try to get the fiscal year of the water district changed, and the utilities committee of the water district reported out the bill ought not to pass. So there was an attempt made. It was not successful.
Are there other questions? Everyone is clear about the motion? All those in favor? I see seven hands. 7-0 passes unanimously. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, gentlemen. I appreciate your coming.
Those are effective February 1st?
Yes.
As per the recommendation, yes. February 1st. Item number 109 this evening is entitled to consider a report on the status of the Cape Elizabeth Fire Department ladder truck and take any necessary action. I would like to defer this item to our town manager, Mr. McGovern,
And I think he will then be asking Chief Murray and Deputy Chief Gleason to make a few comments and to field any particular questions this evening. Do I see Chief Murray? And where is Deputy Chief Gleason? Somewhere. Yes, thank you.
Before Acting Chief Murray speaks, first of all, unfortunately, with everything else we're facing, as everyone read in last week's paper, perhaps, we also had a ladder truck condemned back a few months ago, specifically the aerial that's on it. It did not meet the testing requirements of the National Fire Protection Association in as far as strength is concerned. As a result, none of the volunteers are allowed to climb the ladder or use it. It's felt that it is potentially dangerous and is certainly a liability. The department has been actively working, as will be described, on in trying to come up with a solution. And I'd like to particularly thank Acting Chief Murray for his leadership on this issue. The entire ladder committee, ably led by Deputy Chief Gleason, particularly Gilly Jordan of that committee, who's done an awful lot of work on it. Also, even though Chief Webster has been out sick since mid-October, he's also had some input into the decision-making process as well, and like to thank him. But I would like to use this opportunity, as long as Acting Chief Murray is standing there, to particularly thank him for the exceptional work he has been doing as Acting Fire Chief since early November. And the department has really been in a tough period with the chief out for an extended period. And I think the chief has worked well, and I notice a lot of the volunteers are here this evening, and they have really rallied around getting the job done, and have just done a great job during this period. So we'd like to use this opportunity to thank them as well.
That's certainly seconded by the council members, Chief Murray.
Thank you. I appreciate that comment, but again, without the support from the people who are in the audience tonight, it's an impossible task. You've got to have their support or it's impossible. So without them, they're a great bunch of people, I'll tell you. I'd like to thank the council for entertaining the Ladder Truck Committee's presentation tonight. I would also like to introduce the truck committee to you so you know who they are. Myself, Deputy Chief Gleason, William Jordan Jr., raise your hand, please. Bibb is Captain of Engine 2 Company. Robert Williams, Captain of Engine 1 Company. Keith Jordan, Lieutenant in Engine 2, who I believe is working in Portland Fire Department tonight. Gilbert Jordan, there's Gilly. Gilly's done a lot of legwork on this, a lot of legwork. So, and Public Works Director Bob Malley, who I don't think is here tonight. So they've done a tremendous job on it. Peter's got a nice presentation for you, and without further ado, I'd like to turn it over to Deputy Chief Gleason for the presentation, unless you have any questions.
Thank you very much, Chief Murray.
Thank you.
Thank you, Chief. As the manager stated, in October of 1991, our ladder failed to complete its non-destructive testing successfully. It is the aerial portion of the truck that has been condemned. And what I'd like to do is take you through the process that we went through after that condemnation occurred. In October 91, we formed a ladder truck committee, and the members have been introduced to you, with the sole objective to maintain an aerial ladder in our department and in our community. We believe an aerial ladder is essential for the safety of the community and the safety of the firefighters working. It provides a safe platform for the firefighters to work off of, and is a readily deployable means of rescue if that happens to occur. So with that objective in mind, we formed a committee and we began to look at all our options. At this point, we are relying on mutual aid. Mutual aid is a good short-term solution. It is a good solution when we have a disaster or a fire beyond the capabilities of our department. We do not believe it is a process or a procedure to rely on a consistent basis. There's several factors that are important in mutual aid. Again, it's for situations that exceed the resources of our department, and there was a delay time in that resource aerial ladder being responded from either Scarborough or South Fulton, whichever one happens to be closer. Both trucks are between 15 or roughly 15 to 20 minutes from the center of town, from their stations, depending on weather conditions. Also, both trucks are manned by volunteers. There would be a delay time between the time they were called out and the truck was actually on the road. So with that delay time, that could prove critical in many situations. If we had to wait 15 to 20 minutes for a ladder truck to respond to this area, where our high risks are, our schools, the town hall, it would be even further for, and that's assuming that that aerial ladder that we are calling from the other communities is available to us at that time. If either one happens to be being used by its own community or out of service for whatever reason, we would have to seek assistance from further distances. We are also concerned about using mutual aid on a consistent and routine basis in that it could alienate the other departments from us and also could cause problems with the other communities saying, why are we subsidizing the town of Cape Elizabeth for their fire protection? So we like, the main concern is the delay time and the response distances that would have to be covered from, the ladder trucks would come either from Willard Square in South Poland or from the Scarborough Black Point Station, which is out by Higgins Beach. So again, going back to our objective to maintaining an aerial ladder in our department, we then went back and examined what we had. And I have to go briefly the history of the current truck. We purchased it used in 1975 from South Poland. And in 1980, we undertook a major restoration reconstruction of it. A new chassis and new body was put on. The aerial was transferred from the truck we had purchased in 1975. That was done at a cost of $80,000 with the intention of getting 10 to 15 years service out of the vehicle. So we have gotten the minimum that we thought we would get at that time. In 1990, the truck failed its non-destructive testing, but we were able to effect repairs, but we were advised at that time that those repairs would probably only last for a year, and that at the next test, the truck would probably fail again. And it did fail in 1991. It has what is called five Category 1 defects, and Category 1 defects necessitate the truck be taken out of service until those defects can be repaired. A couple of the defects can be repaired, but two of the major ones cannot be. And we've been in contact with the original manufacturer, who is C-grade, and they do not sanction any repairs to that aerial for its age, which is approximately 40 years old, and the extent of the defects. And without that sanction and direction from the original manufacturer, we don't believe we can get a refurbisher that is knowledgeable in fire service to do the work on the truck. So with that option gone, that we could no longer, or we could not, we were unable to repair the truck, we then looked at other possibilities, the first one being exploring the option of buying another used aerial to mount on that chassis, where it's approximately 11 years old at this point. The trouble with that is that most aerials that will fit on that current chassis are of the